Cape Cod, Massachusetts, is known for its beautiful beaches. This scenic landscape is also home to one of the most frequent marine mammal stranding sites in the world. Scientists know very little about what causes these animals to strand. What has been proven is that a quick and efficient response in these moments is a matter of life and death.
If we can get there quickly and provide supportive care, they have a much better prognosis in terms of survival.
Katie Moore works on the front lines as the Deputy Vice President of Conservation and Animal Welfare at the International Fund for Animal Welfare. Through Katie's fine-tuned rescue efforts, she has increased the survival rate from 14 to 75%. But the question remains, could it be possible to predict rather than react to these events?
If we can develop an algorithm that pieces together the different variables that may be causing mass strandings or driving mass strandings, then we have the ability to then prevent them. We can have teams that are out on the shore looking for animals in those hotspots, knowing that all those variables have come together and this is the likely point in time where we're likely to see it. But we can also have teams ready to respond so that if they do strand, we're there that much faster and more animals will survive the event.
In Cape Cod, the annual number of stranded animals ranges from less than 10 to over 200. Some of the most affected species include pilot whales and white-sided dolphins, creatures that are typically found in deeper water rather than along the coast. The ongoing search for answers began 400 miles away at the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management in Sterling, Virginia. There, fellow marine biologist Desiree Reeb had some initial thoughts on triggers for these events.
For the large proportion of these strandings, the animals are across the ages, in pretty good health, and there's no really immediate evidence as to why they actually strand.
Geomagnetic perception, or the ability to navigate using Earth's magnetic field, is a feature thought to exist in marine mammals. Could changes in the magnetic field confuse the animals? All the way down to the sea floor, sensors like magnetometers can detect changes in Earth's magnetic field, called geomagnetic pulses or storms. One cause of such changes is activity from the sun, known as space weather.
Geomagnetic perception is one of the theories. And I thought, well, if a magnetometer can pick it up, maybe the animals actually can pick it up.
Dr. Reeb brought her hypothesis to Antti Pulkkinen, research astrophysicist from the Heliophysics Department at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland.
The coolest thing was that we realized that nobody had really taken a cold, hard data science analysis look at the problems.
By combining Katie's records on marine mammal strandings in Cape Cod and Antti's records of the changes in Earth's magnetic field, the team of researchers had a starting point.
What we were trying to look at here was if there was a potential driver or relationship or correlation between the occurrence of mass strandings and any solar activity.
The data that we have correlated or analyzed so far is information about the local geomagnetic conditions. We have long data records from geophysical observatories of the local geomagnetic field variations and marine mammal strandings.
When the team analyzed all the data, they found that measurements from the same time period, or random time periods, produced similar results, meaning that there is no obvious relationship between geomagnetic changes and strandings in Cape Cod. If space weather wasn't the trigger, what could be?
The easy fix correlation between a geomagnetic pulse and, a stranding doesn't seem to be very evident, but what it does show is that there are multiple variables involved in this equation, and that the geomagnetic storms could just be one very small part of it. Significant still, but it looks like there are multiple oceanographic and environmental elements.
The scientists considered what other variables may exist in the air or water that could change animal behavior. Tides or winds could be disruptive. Ocean color, measurements of the water's chemical and particle content, could reflect changes in the food chain. Perhaps sea surface temperature was a factor too. With the help of data from NASA Earth Science missions, they could also explore these possibilities.
To me personally, it's really, you know, driving also an additional motivation in doing something about this.
With more data on hand, it was time to expand the team. They recruited statisticians and the expertise of NASA Earth Science data analyst and oceanographer Erdem Karakulu.
A data set, no matter its shape or content, always has a story to tell. Trying to figure out how different data are connected, I think, require a wide diversity of skills and background knowledge.
For example, I'll be explaining how a mass stranding occurs and how we respond to try and understand why I'm presenting the data in a certain way. And my colleagues from NASA will look at me and ask questions that I wouldn't think to ask because I take for granted my understanding. And they're coming at it from a totally new angle with no background.
The group hopes to combine these data sets in a way that reveals a pattern, allowing them to predict the likelihood and location of mass strandings before they happen.
We've really just sort of slowly peeled the first layer of this onion back. And I think that there's so many more layers that still need to be addressed and looked at. And I hope that we can actually find additional collaborators, additional funding partners, to really bring all the data that's really available to really give this the study and the scrutiny that it deserves.
And we are also going to make all these data sets available to the entire scientific community so that we can utilize the entire scientific community to take an attack and approach this problem.
The project's legacy rests not only in a predictive tool, but also as an example for collaborative research moving forward.
I think that there will be other things that to take and run with, get new ideas, maybe add more data. And I'm hoping also that will be a model for how projects can then be open to the wider public.
Just follow you guys that way.
With the potential for an even broader collaboration ahead, Katie's rescue team is optimistic that they will gain a deeper understanding of strandings and ultimately save more lives.
The ability to release animals after they've stranded is tremendous. When we do that, I mean, that's the best feeling in the world after all of that hard work.
Those questions that seem unanswerable, if you give them time and support and effort and put people on them, we can do amazing things.